በስመ አብ ወወልድ ወመንፈስ ቅዱስ አሃዱ አምላክ አሜን. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Then Jesus, led by the Spirit, went into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, and he fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Fathers, brothers and sisters in Christ, with the most humble of hearts, greetings to you all. I hope everybody's doing well. Glory be to God for giving us this moment, this wonderful time, this wonderful day, this wonderful year, to praise Him, to honor Him, to glorify Him, and to worship Him. And truly, glory be to Him for giving us another wonderful Lent season. I hope everybody is just as excited as I am for this wonderful season to come, because fasting is a season that our soul truly rejoices and delights in the Lord, because fasting is to willingly obey the commandments of our God, to receive mercy through mourning, forgiveness through pleading, and blessing through seeking. And it's a time that we weaken and sacrifice the desire of our flesh so that our soul can be strengthened. Strength is not the absence of weakness. Rather, strength is progression in the presence of weakness. So now during the season of fasting, we are to unburden everything that our fleshly desires has burdened on us outside of the fasting season. This is the perfect time to build a certain momentum so that once the fasting season is over, we have the strength to overcome all the temptation and the desires of the flesh. This is a perfect time to reconnect with God. When we are focused on our fleshly life in the secular world, we tend to stray from God most of the time. It doesn't mean we are dead to God. It just simply means that we're not as focused as we need to be. So now during fasting season, our soul actually connects with the Lord, and we have this wonderful relationship, and we start walking in spirit rather than the flesh, right? So when it comes to strengthening the soul, it doesn't necessarily mean killing the flesh, right? This is exactly what our Lord and our God Jesus Christ taught us, right? When you fast, you have to make sure that you're not just doing it to be pretentious and just like as the other people do. You need to do it in the rightly so, because when you do fasting in the proper way, you prosper even in your flesh. That's which is why most of our generation nowadays are vegan or vegetarian, because when you eat healthy, when you stop this comfortness of the world and start taking care of your body, you become this wonderful, healthier, you become more active, you are more focused and interactive. These are essential things for the flesh as well. So not only are you strengthening your soul, but you are bettering your flesh as well, because this body is the temple of God as well. And the body or the temple of God needs to be taken care of so that you are the proper host, the proper spirit is within you as well. So when you start, there is two misconceptions about this fasting season in general. There are those who think they're losing something by fasting or not eating. And then there's some of us who think just because we're not eating, we're losing something. And that is not true at all. In fact, when we read 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 8, St. Paul talks about how food doesn't commend us to God. That's, it means like it doesn't lead us to God. It's not a path to God. Food doesn't commend us to God, but he says, neither are we better if we eat, nor are we worse if we do not eat. So there is nothing to lose if we do not eat at all. In fact, there is something to gain from not eating and abstaining from food and dairy and the comfort of life in general. We start walking in spirit. When we start reading Galatians chapter 6, verse 15, St. Paul talks about how, when We need to walk in the spirit, because the flesh is contrary to the soul and the soul is contrary to the flesh. They do not match, they do not mingle. So therefore, you must not do anything that you desire to do. Therefore, fasting is something that we need to look forward to in general. There are two types of fast, of course, within the Orthodox Tewahedo Church. There is a personal fast. This is the fast that we all do personally. There are times where we feel weak in our spiritual life. There are times where we need to be connected with God. So we take this fasting and then we apply it to our life, and we fast by communicating with our spiritual father. And then there is a proclamation, canonized fast, that we all need to fast as a family of Christ in general. This is exactly what the early Christians did. This is what our forefathers told us. This is what the apostles amended. When we read Acts chapter 13, Acts chapter 14, when we see the church of Antioch as well as Galatia, you see the congregation all came together and prayed and fasted, and we were able to see the result of their devotion through the results, the fruit of that devotion. They sent Barnabas and Saul on their way, and then they were able to actually pick and choose church leader in these times, because the Holy Spirit was able to reveal to them what the truth is. So it's essential for us to fast all these proclamation fasts, because there's a lot of people who would question our church, like, what do you guys need to fast? It's like, it's not amended, it's not allowed. It's a canonized law. This is exactly what the early churches did. This is exactly what the apostles did. This is what our forefathers did to keep our, you know, to preserve our church and its true nature. And this is exactly what we will do today to preserve the beautiful church that we have been given by Christ, and then to the apostles, and then to the forefathers. And we must pass down this canonized beautiful tradition to the next generation as well. There are seven fasts, of course, canonized fast, and then one minor fast in the season of Tsigim. Now, this fast that we are fasting right now, one of the seven, of course, being the biggest one, Lent season. It's a beautiful season. Some people call it Hudade, which, you know, drives from the Giz word Hudade, which means wide or broad. And then some people call it Abis Om, which translates to the Great Lent in general. It has a very common understanding, common thing. We fast for 40 days, for 40 nights, but this is a fast that we do actually for 55 days, although our Lord and our God Jesus Christ fasted for 55 days. 40 is a number that represents cleansing and preparation within the scripture. We are able to see in the book of Genesis, during the time of Noah, it rained for 40 days and for 40 nights while God cleansed the whole world. And then we see it again in the life of the Israelites. They wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. So while God kind of reforms and cleanses their rebellion ideas and ideologies, right? And then there we see Moses again within Mount Sinai fasting for 40 days and for 40 nights before he was able to receive the Ark of the Covenant as well as the Old Testament, which is Orit, and then he able to establish that way of connection with God. And we're able to see it in the life of Enoch. He fasted 40 days before he was taken to Beera Heawan, which is the nation of eternal. We were able to see it in the life of Ezekiel. We were able to see it in the life of Ezra, who fasted 40 days, 40 nights. And then he was able to rewrite a lot of lost scriptures that we had lost. We see it in a lot of the prophets as well as the apostles. Before they begun their ministry, they fasted for 40 days, for 40 nights. And our Lord and our God Jesus Christ, of course, fasted 40 days and 40 nights before he begun his ministry. So 40 days is a number that represents preparation and cleansing as well. So then why do we fast 55 days? And this is actually also amended by the apostles as well as our forefathers as well. It is taught that we must fast this beautiful fast right before Passion Week, that 1 week, and then the week before Lent season, before the 40 days. So why do we fast 55 days if Christ only fasted 40 days? This is because we have two additional weeks, one in the beginning of the fasting season and then one at the end. The one at the end is in remembrance of Passion Week. This is where we commemorate the persecution the crucifixion, the death and the resurrection of our Lord and our God Jesus Christ. And the one at the beginning is considered to be a preparation week for the Great Lent season. And it's also because there was a man named Hirakal who helped a lot of Christians who were being persecuted. They begged him for help, and then he asked them in return for their help, because the consequence for killing a person at the time was you have to fast the rest of your life, you have to live in repentance, and you have to live in this isolated situation. And that he didn't want that to happen, so the Christians all came together and said, we will fast this fast for you, because there is a lot of us. So we have taken that, and then now we use this wonderful time as a preparation for the Great Lent season as well. So this for and then Saint Yared beautifully set up all 8 weeks in a beautiful theme. Now this week is themed Zewerede, or he who came down from the heavens. And then we remember the incarnation of our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ, who descended from the heavens, taking flesh and rational soul from the Holy Virgin Mary and becoming man. And this is a beautiful way to start the fast, because the end of the fast actually commemorates his death. So we begin by remembering his incarnation, and we finish by remembering his death and celebrating his resurrection. It's truly amazing and mesmerizing. Another reason as to why this is because when we have this 55 days, because we don't count Saturday and Sunday because they are Sabbath, and we get to eat very, very early in the morning because liturgy is early in the morning. And because of that, we don't count the weekends. So if you just count the weekdays from today all the way to resurrection, you will find 40 days pure, 40 days that we would fast from morning to late evening. So this is why our forefathers made this beautiful, beautiful law, so that we would fast 55 days rather than just simply 40. It's just incredible. So it's important for us to begin this Lent by understanding the whole concept as to why we fasted, which is to celebrate his resurrection. And in order to remember his resurrection, we must remember his death and his crucifixion, what was sacrificed on our behalf. And then to actually understand that, we must know that he descended. It was God that descended from the heavens, taking flesh and rational soul from the Holy Virgin Mary, becoming one of us, and then actually showing us the way. So when you remember Zewerede, he's like God coming down from the heavens, because we are unable to understand the concept of humanity, because we were not understanding how to be humans. God, actually the one that created us, came down from the heavens, and he says, this is how you need to walk as a righteous being. So whenever we remember this week, whenever we are in this week, we need to actually sit back and actually understand what we need to do in order for us to walk in the path that he has walked, for us to be as perfect or as our Heavenly Father is perfect, just so that we can be this, we can fulfill the purpose of humanity in general. But why are we created? And what way should we walk? And all these things will be clear to us when we actually follow, when we are in fellowship with God. Whoever wants to be my follower, whoever wants to be my servant, they must carry the cross and follow me, right? So we are following the footsteps of our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ, so that we can inherit the kingdom of heaven. So he came down from the heavens and he started showing us the way. And the very first thing that he did was, of course, baptism. And then he went into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And he fasted while fasting 40 days and 40 nights, right? So this is huge. It shows that before we do anything, we need to fast. And when we fast, we are able to overcome any temptation that is in this world. Because these are like the three key things that used to really kill humanity. Three things that he defeated with his fast. That is greed, pride, and prestige and wealth. These are three things that were corrupting humanity. So he was able to defeat this temptation in the wilderness right after his fasting, and showing us how powerful this tool is. When we apply fasting and prayer to our lifestyle, we are immune to this world. This world means nothing to us. We become more attracted and gravitated to the heavenly realm rather than the earthly realm. we become more like the angels who praise him and honor him and glorify him all the time. They do not eat food. Praise is their food. So us avoiding food is as if we are resembling the angels, how they praise him and honor him in the heavens as well. So the very first thing that he overcame in the wilderness was, of course, greed. The devil approached our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ, and he says, you know, if you are the Son of God, turn this stone into a bread and we can eat. This is greed, right? So, and then Christ replied by quoting from the scripture. He says, a man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So this shows you should not live for your just a survival. That's not the whole concept of humanity. Do not be selfish, because this is what the world teaches us nowadays. Just worry about yourself, what you're going to eat, and then just go to sleep. We forget about everything else. But when we live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of our Creator, the Word of God talks about we need to fast, we need to pray, we need to be in communion with Him, we need to be charitable, we need to be loving, we need to love everyone that is around us, love those who hate us, and pray for those who persecute us. And all these things, this is what the Word of God is. It's about living in communion, living as a family of Christ. But when we live for the world, we only are concerned about what we eat, our personal goals and our personal ambitions only. And we do not apply anything for the rest of the world. As long as we eat, we don't care about who eats or who doesn't eat. As long as we're clothed, we don't care who is unclothed and struggling. As long as we have a home, we don't care who doesn't have a home, who's homeless, and who is in so much need. So this actually is a huge issue that we have with ourselves as well. This is why St. Paul talks about whatever you do, do everything for the glory of God. That means applying everything according to God's will and desire. When we apply everything that we do with God's desire, even if we have daily bread or something to eat or something to receive or an income or a home or extra clothing, we also think about being charitable as well. So that we think about the Word of God. This is exactly what Christ is trying to teach us. So defeating greed with being charitable and actually considering everybody else as well, and living by the law, because His law is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path as well. This is essential. Two is pride. And we have to defeat pride with humility. So at this point, when Christ replied back to him with the scripture, the devil came back with a different scripture. So he took him to the pinnacle of the temple, and he says, you know, if you throw yourself from this top of the temple, God will send you his angels, and you will survive. And he actually quoted from Psalms 91 to test him in this manner. And Christ replied back again with a scripture. He says, you shall not tempt your Lord your God. This is Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16 as well. So there are two things right here that we need to understand. First, that the devil is a lot smarter than we think. He quoted the scripture. He actually reads the scripture, unlike a lot of us who struggle with the scripture. I'm sure you go through it as well, whether you are at school, whether you are at work, whether you're just walking, whether you are taking a taxi. It doesn't really matter. You are tested by something or someone who comes at you with a scripture. The scripture says this. What do you have to say for that? And then automatically, we have no answer for it. So we start doubting our faith, doubting our God, doubting everything that we believe. This is a real issue. This is because we're not in tune or in touch with the Holy Scripture. So this is important for us to understand. Just as St. Peter says, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ. And not only that, he goes on to say, you must have an answer. You must be prepared to answer for all the questions that people have for you. So you must understand, you must be wise as a serpent, and then humble and kind as a dove, just as our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ, taught us. And secondly, pride is the downfall of humanity. He's basically saying, oh no, just throw yourself. If you think you're all that, of course, if you think your God is real, he can save you. And we are tested by this as well. And pride is one of our weaknesses. You know, the moment we have everything going on for us, the moment we feel like we got it all, we feel like we're on top of everybody and we start looking on down on people. The moment we, you know, we get a certain status within the church, whenever we become a servant, whenever we have a little prestige, we forget all humility, and then we feel like we've done it all. It's just all our work, and everybody else is just not working as hard. And we forget that it's God actually that give us all this beautiful things that we have, which is why in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 23, it reads, "One's pride will bring him low, but he who is lowly in the spirit will obtain honor." So when we humble ourselves before people, when we humble ourselves before everybody else, then we are only honored from then on. Last but not least, the last temptation that he defeated was wealth and prestige. So he took him to a higher mountain and he showed him all the kingdoms of the world, and he says, if you bow down to me, I'll give you everything else. And then our Lord rebuked him. He said, away from me, Satan, you should only bow down and worship God, and you should only serve him. And this is one of the things that we all struggle with, this ambition that we have to be the wealthiest people, the most prestigious people in this world. And for us, the ultimate goal, the ultimate happiness comes from receiving all these things. And to receive all these things, we go above and beyond. We bend over for the world and we lose ourselves. This is a huge problem that we have, and we need to be better at this. I actually understand, well, it's only when we worship God, when we serve him, only then we find true happiness. Everything that we see, all the glamorous things in the world that we see, doesn't really give us happiness. That's why all the wealthy people within the world are not happy at all, are not complete. They do whatever. They travel, they buy all these material things, thinking that it would complete the void that is in their heart. That's impossible. That's impossible. The only thing that would fulfill a person, sustain a person, is the word of God, being in communion with him and magnifying and glorifying and rejoicing in the Lord, which is why when we read Matthew chapter 19, verse 24, reads this, "Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle rather than a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." And we all know the story where the prestigious and wealthiest man came to our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ, and asked him, like, "I've done all great things. I've followed all the rule. What else can I do to enter the kingdom of heaven?" And Christ says, "Sell all your belongings and give your wealth to the poor and follow me." And that was impossible for him. He walked away, and Christ said, all this thing is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle. Imagine how impossible that is. So when we start focusing our life, when we put, you know, the wealth of the world and prestige beyond everything and above everything else, then God becomes insignificant. But when we make God significant in our life, everything else becomes insignificant, and everything will be blessed for us. When we seek the kingdom of heaven, only then all the prestige and wealth will be added for us, because we're doing it in the right way, because it comes from God. And we're able to let it go at any time. It doesn't, you know, what most people think is like, oh, money is evil. No. You are to be blessed. It's just that you need to make sure at the core of your lifestyle, it's God first. And you are willing to let go of this wealth and prestige. Most of us are unable to do so because we love wealth and prestige more than we love God. And that's exactly what we saw in Matthew chapter 19. So when we are able to put God first, when we worship him, when we serve him, everything else is irrelevant. And that's what we see. God, the Satan was like, "I'll give you all these things." And for Christ, of course, as an example, being an example for us, it didn't mean anything to him. He created everything that he has shown him. It didn't mean anything. But he is trying to show us, like, if you are in my position, this is the way you need to reply it. Reply by saying, you rebuke him, and I don't need anything from you. I only need to serve God, and I only need to worship him, and everything else will be added for me. So with that, he defeated the three most temptatious things in this universe. With that, I'll leave you. May the blessing of the Father, the glory of the Son, the life of the Holy Spirit, the intercession of the Holy Virgin Mary, the helping hands of all the saints and all the angels be with all of you. Dose, 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 Dose,
ጸባኦት አምላክ ነህ።